Hello everybody, and welcome to the second game of Warzone Ultimate Series. This time around, amerlafrance was playing versus Georgie. And this particular template is very similar to the previous one. But the two main differences are, first, it's the original medium AF map. And it has East Russia at 7 territories, and the Eastern United States at 7 territories as well. Now, our big change is that this game has got luck setting. So basically, rounding mode is set to weighted random. So how exactly does it work? So the kill rate is something like 60% for the offense and 70% for the defense. So that could be used to check how exactly the situation will be going. For example, three armies normally kill two defending armies. So let's say three armies multiplied by 0.6, it's 1.8. So in order to perform a rounding mode, right now what would be done, you take 0.8 and you check the chance that way. And because it is 0.8, it is 80% chance that it will be two armies killed, and 20% chance that it will be one army killed. So because of that, attacking with three armies means that it has 80% chance to succeed. And for example, if you go with higher numbers, like for example with four armies, the chance immediately becomes 100%. And if you go with less than three armies, the chance immediately should become something like zero. Because something like if you attack with two armies, you only kill 1.2 armies, so you take then that 20% you kill. For example, 2-on-2 attack has 20% chance to succeed, and then it also has 80% chance to fail. And it's all because due to rounding mode. Of course, if you're going to attack two armies with two armies, which is a bad idea, but the next thing you need to check is defensive kill rate. Like defensive positions, like two defending armies multiplied by 0.7 is 1.4, and it means that two defending armies have 40% chance to only kill one army, which is normal. Like if it was a straight rounding mode, two defending armies kill one attacking army. But now because it is weighted random, it's only 40% chance that one army will get killed in defense, and 60% chance that two armies will be killed. So basically it means that it makes the situation pretty difficult, and it's much harder to predict how many armies you will have after your attack, and it's much harder to plan your expansion a few turns into the future. Basically everything is possible, and it's possible to create tools which could account for the probabilities and check what is likely, what is unlikely. I still I have done this in the past, but right now I don't have a tool with myself. So I guess I will evaluate everything on a hunch. Personally, luck settings are not very popular, so in the recent months, years, I haven't had much experience with luck in particular, but still more or less the same logic applies. Like, if you attack with three armies, you are likely to take neutral. And then basically what I do, I try to avoid luck as much as possible, and I try to attack neutrals with four armies. Like for example, if there was a situation I wanted to take Scandinavian Peninsula and I would want to use three armies, like three attacks of three armies, it would mean that every single time that 80% chance would multiply. So if I attack three times with three armies, I will only have something like 51.2% chance of succeeding. So normally, even first turn bonus on this setting has a chance to fail. Basically, because you can only attack two territories with four armies, and at least one territory requires an attack of three armies, so it means that first turn bonuses have a chance of being unreliable. But still, this weighted rounding mode affects all the attacks, it affects all the aspects of expansion. Yes, it's harder to get first turn bonus, but it's also harder to get any bonus as well. So another thing, like when it's a straight rounding mode, often players attempt to go for one bonus with two picks and another bonus with one pick, and they end up with taking one 3 income and another 4 income bonus in 2 turns. Meaning they end up with 2 turns with 12 income. Now in this kind of scenario, because of involved luck, this might not be as easily achieved as expected. So one thing which could be done is trying to go for a little bit less, maybe going for one 3 income bonus with 2 picks and another 3 income bonus with 1 pick. So now looking at the map itself, it looks like West Africa is pretty safe, and now Central America is also a good position, same with South Africa. I meant South America, but when you want to pick and there's a lot of bottlenecks involved, like in this situation, the best thing would be picking Colombia, because for example, if opponent is in Mexico, you still get to expand into Ghana. If opponent is in Ghana, you still get to expand into Mexico. And if you lose Colombia, then maybe you get to pick somewhere else, which might be better. And if you get South America, at least you can be guaranteed that you will be taking at least one bonus, which is like efficient bonus. Like for example, both East United States and West United States, they are both big bonuses with low bonus income per territory ratio. So right now, looking at the map, I see a lot of efficient bonuses in Asia, like straight to Australia. And now important thing is that because Scott is wasteland, it means that Australia naturally becomes a more likely pick. Like it's a safe bonus right now because of that, and a player could build up armies and attack Malaysia with a heavy amount of armies and hope to surprise Thailand and break Southeast Asia with ease. Or if opponent is not in Thailand, he could take Thailand full force. Hope that Hong Kong is being crushed with ease. If our opponent is only in West China, then you could take Hong Kong and hope to easily crush West China. Because Malaysia to Thailand to Hong Kong to West China is a big chain of bonuses. Each of them can be surprised, and because there's a lot of bonuses involved, this particular region is probably going to get at least some opponent attention. So Australia could be used to make some surprise counters. Now another thing is probably West Russia and the Scandinavian Peninsula are good positions to start. But unfortunately, they do not have much expansion routes, and available expansion routes are basically not very good. Like both Middle East and both Europe are not as efficient. So basically, we sleeps like one option probably is going to be Central America, which is a first and bonus. So probably both players should focus their first two picks on it. And our focus probably would be then something about Asia, like to Australia. And maybe some backup picks in West Russia or Scandinavian Peninsula, or maybe West Africa might even work. Basically, I predict that all the focus is going to be Central America plus South America, and it would go into straight into Australia to West China. So now I have already opened the picks of amerlafrance. So I can already see that he's making better picks than in his previous game. He's no longer sticking to one area 100%. And I think going for Texas is still unnecessary, because basically between Mexico and Colombia, amerlafrance is guaranteed to get at least one of his picks. Now another thing is because third, fourth, and fifth picks are all in the same place, it means amerlafrance is going to get at least one of his picks. So let's say, like the opponent might get his first move, like he gets first pick somewhere else. And now when amerlafrance gets Mexico and Colombia, that leaves opponent with, let's say, two picks, like Solomon Islands, New South Wales, and then amerlafrance has to get Thailand. Now, if amerlafrance gets first pick, then opponent again gets two picks somewhere here. And amerlafrance then gets third pick as Colombia, like his next pick would be somewhere in the Australia region as well. So it's possible to pick first two picks, and those two picks, one of them is guaranteed to be yours. And then you can follow up with third, fourth, and fifth picks being somewhere else close by. And it would mean that at least one of those picks will be yours as well. So our one for the sixth pick, amerlafrance's picks are okay. Maybe he could have tried to pick Hong Kong over Thailand, but it's just I guess a personal preference. He could have moved his sixth pick into Hong Kong. I think that would be a good improvement. Now for Georgie, he does make some similar decisions, but basically he puts a priority over Sweden. Just because it makes a priority over Sweden means that what could possibly happen is that Georgie gets his first pick as first order. So what it means when amerlafrance gets his own two picks and he steals Mexico and Colombia that way. Now if that happens, Georgie did make Texas as an option, and it could work, it might not have. Because what if, let's say he got first pick, amerlafrance steals two picks, then Georgie gets his next two picks. So now basically looking at it, it means that sixth pick is basically unimportant. Because basically if Georgie gets first pick, even if, let's say, he loses these two picks, it means he gets his fourth and fifth pick, the fourth and fifth pick by default. And if something else manages to happen, basically it would be something like Georgie having two picks versus one pick from amerlafrance, which is not good. Another thing is that I think it's George's picks are well like made for the Hong Kong and New South Wales situation. But of course, he needs to be careful about Solomon Islands, because right now entirety of Indonesia is a bottleneck bonus. So amerlafrance could go for Indonesia and have an easy foothold in it. An important thing to see is that Indonesia is between East China and Australia, so amerlafrance could try to border road bonuses, and he could try to go on one bonus 100%, and he might lose Indonesia in the process, but he may then as well he might break another bonus. And judging by how the territories and everything else is positioned, probably amerlafrance would be better off trying to break Australia if he was in Solomon Island. Because for East China, there's always a possibility to try to go all the way around, all the way through Hawaii, all the way through Japan, Korea. And there's just way more options to assault East China than, for example, to assault Australia. And Australia has also one more income. So if amerlafrance manages to break Australia, it will be -4 income for amerlafrance, -5 income for Georgie, and +1 net income gain for amerlafrance. So it's time to check how things turned out. So basically, Georgie has one unchallenged pick, and amerlafrance has two unchallenged picks. So amerlafrance has much better expansion options, and in the meantime, Georgie probably will have to defend two of his picks against one of pick from amerlafrance. And also, Georgie probably has a little bit. He might have a little bit of challenge while expanding. Amerlafrance has like 11-15 income if I just add up all the efficient bonuses next to Amerlafrance. Now for Georgie, probably will be able to go for West China and West Russia. That's something like 18 income, I believe. Like if you add Australia, Scandinavian Peninsula, West Russia, that's I believe 12 income, 18 income, okay, 22 income. But it has to be remembered that Georgia will be the one being challenged, and amerlafrance will be able to expand freely where he wants. Amerlafrance doesn't have to take Indonesia, he could just go straight for offense over Georgia because. Amerlafrance did lose his pick in South Australia, so Amerlafrance is aware of George's position, and he could try to at least make a stalemate situation where one pick is being traded for another one. So Amerlafrance is in good position right now. So now it's back to all player perspective. And George is probably going to try to expand safely with four army attacks. While in the meantime, amerlafrance took a risk and it didn't pay off. Basically, the chances to take Central America is 50-50, somewhere close to that for amerlafrance. And instead, he decided to go for Papua New Guinea with five armies, which is a mistake because Papua New Guinea only requires like four armies to be attacked with for 100% success rate. So amerlafrance could have tried to deploy one extra army to take Central America, and that would increase amerlafrance's chances from something like 50-50 to like 64% chance to succeed. And now Georgie got unfortunate because both neutrals managed to kill two armies in return, so it's basically something like only 36% chance for that. So it's immediately possible to see that Georgie has 5 income. So basically, if it was a straight round game, Georgie would need to use every single of his income on that. And now, because Georgie has to deal with weighted random mode, he needs to count on taking every single of his 5 territories and not losing a single extra army in the process, which is unlikely, because each neutral has a 60% chance to kill 2 armies. So Georgie is in bad position basically. And now, okay, so now the game is going on, and Georgia won't be able to take Queensland, Western Australia, and Tasmania at the same time. Amerlafrance could try to go hard on Queensland, or he might want to wait. But attacking first is probably the best option, because Georgia could just sit and try to stonewall Queensland if he takes it first before Amerlafrance. So Amerlafrance goes heavily on Queensland, while in the meantime, Georgia on the previous turn went 100% on Australia, and right now he is making expansion elsewhere, so it feels like losing focus. Like Georgia maybe realized that Australia was not the best option for him. But instead, at that point, he already had made his decision, so it was no longer like 5 armies for 6 territories. It was 5 armies for 3 territories. So I guess Georgia also didn't expect to meet Amerlafrance in Queensland. I guess that's a factor too. Now, another thing, of course, is could Georgie have taken multiple bonuses at the same time? Could he have possibly taken Australia and another bonus like at the same time? Could he have tried to go for Scandinavian Peninsula and hope that he gets lucky? But still, I don't think it would be 100% chance. And when you are dealing with this type of games, you could do some calculations, but that would take a lot of time. You would need to account for scenarios where defending neutral kill one army, scenarios where defending neutral kill two armies. So basically, I guess the proper math should be done with attacking with four armies. So let's say Queensland would be taken. It would have something like two neutral, like two armies left. It would require like plus 3 income. This New Zealand would require plus 2 income. So basically, Georgia was in no position to take multiple bonuses at the same time. So if I was him, I just would focus on taking Australia, and instead I would have taken Scandinavian Peninsula with 4, like Norway with 4, so that I could take Scandinavian Peninsula once I have already taken the Australia bonus. So now Merlefrance is I guess trying to expand further. Now I see that Merlefrance deployed enough to have enough to take 4 neutrals with 4 armies each. But I see that he only attacked one of them with 4 armies, and he attacked another neutral with 3 armies. So he made a risk. And if attack would fail, it would mean that Merlefrance would leave one neutral in the Philippines. So if you leave one army neutral, it's a possible alert to the opponent that you are nearby. So if you try to expand very heavily and you make a lot of three army attacks, you need to account for the fact that opponent might be nearby and he will be alerted by that one neutral and he will try to get to your bonus before you can complete it. So I guess Georgie again is trying to take all the three bonuses at the same time. And it is a kind of our expansion because that combined with weighted random being applied, it just means that Georgia doesn't really have a chance to take any of his bonuses like very quickly. And he should focus on one bonus 100% if he wants to do things fast and if he wants to build up some quick income. So right now Georgie again is making some risky moves because two attacks of three armies is only like 64% of chance to succeed. And I don't think that Georgie is in a position to necessarily protect the Queensland well. I guess he could have tried to make sure that Taiwan is being taken 100%. And he could have tried to attack Taiwan hard, so he could attack Philippines hard afterwards. Now, he also could have tried to make a small blockade in New Zealand, so to ensure that amerlafrance cannot take Australia efficiently. And Georgia could have hoped to take Philippines and make a more or less equal trade that amerlafrance would take out one bonus, but Georgia would be able to take out one bonus as well. And it looks like for Georgia, he did get lucky and he did take the East China bonus, but it was a risk. Now, it looks like Georgia, no. He could have tried to blockade New South Wales, and that would be a decent blockade, which would have prevented amerlafrance from having easy time with Australia. And instead, Georgia could have tried to 100% focus on breaking Philippines, and that would have given him perhaps a better fighting chance. Now, amerlafrance, of course, is going to protect himself very well because it's very close to getting Indonesia. And I guess George is continuing to make risky expansion because, yet again, attacking East China was only something like 64% chance of success. Taking Scandinavian Peninsula right now is again 64% chance, and now you combine those two things together, it's something like around 40% chance that both of these plans would have gone through. So basically, George is risking of losing, like this time, he's losing to lose three income. And he's risking to be forced to attack same neutral twice, which is another cost. If he played safe, yes, he would need to deploy two extra armies, but if he does fail this time, it means much greater losses for him. So he needed to check his likelihood of succeeding. And he should have tried to minimize the risk because minimizing the risk was much cheaper than actually going with it and getting much bigger losses down the road. So now, again, predictably, Georgia failed to take one of his territories, and because of that, he's down three income and he will have to attack same neutral again. And okay, he'll be able to take it without any extra deploys, but it's something like four lost armies just by trying to make a risky move by hoping to get lucky. So in the meantime, he also did he didn't bother to blockade New Zealand, and he should have, because it should have been possible for him to check previous moves, and it should have been possible for him to see what kind of order he'll be getting, first turn or second turn. Now, in the settings, I will quickly check. So, okay, move order is random, so with that being depicted, it means that, yeah, I guess Georgie couldn't have relied on the first turn order, but instead he could have still tried to blockade New South Wales before, and even with two armies on that territory, it would still make it something like seven army neutral, which still would provide at least some slowdown into amerlafrance's expansion. Because right now, George is down in income, he has to protect Taiwan, and he is at disadvantage, so there's no way he can protect both New Zealand and both Taiwan at the same time. So, in particular, I really don't like how amerlafrance chose to expand into the West United States, because it's something like 8 territories for 5 income, because it's important to see that Texas is 4 army neutral, so when you start your game, it's best to focus 100% on your starting bonuses, because all the surrounding bonuses on strategic 1v1, like a ladder template or this particular version, all the surrounding bonuses will have one neutral with raised value. Like for example, in this case, Texas has two additional neutrals, so it can be taken like West United States having additional territory. So amerlafrance is really making an inefficient expansion decision to go into West United States. It would have been much better for him to instead focus on South America, because right now it's 4 territories for 4 income. In the meantime, West United States was 8 territories for 5 income. So South America was much better expansion route. So again, George tries to dodge an attack with only 3 armies. And he needs to realize that he must play perfectly. Yeah, because just one single mistake, just one simple failed attack, and he won't be able to dodge amerlafrance. So basically, if you try to dodge again and again and you use 3 armies attack for that, it just means that eventually you're going to fail and eventually your attempt will be stopped. And now, because George made that failed attack, now amerlafrance will have easier time taking Tasmania, and he will have easier time taking New Zealand. So it's like a bad situation for George. I guess amerlafrance just tries to stall the situation in East China. Because basically, how this situation could be viewed, it could be viewed two ways. One way is that amerlafrance gets too overconfident and it doesn't protect very well in Philippines. Or he tries to attack Taiwan with not enough armies because he thinks that he already has advantage. Therefore, taking Taiwan should be easy for him. The other point of view is that because George is down in income and because it's like his only bonus right now, he probably will try to defend it 100%, making sure that he doesn't lose his bonus. So amerlafrance probably made the correct decision and he decided to protect Philippines with just enough to make sure that George doesn't take it back, doesn't break it. And instead focus on some different area, like for example making sure that New Zealand is being taken. And if Georgia was smarter, he could have just again protected Taiwan with just enough for it to stand still. and instead try to maybe deploy a little bit to New Zealand and try to blockade it. So now it's interesting to see how things go. And it looks like did the players already have order delays? Yeah. Actually, no, but again, I guess amerlafrance was being too overconfident. But fortunately for him, all of his Georgie play has left him out of extra armies, because all these extra failed attacks, they mean that George's army count goes down and he has less and less leftovers. And the less and less leftovers he has, the less delay orders he can make. And because of that, it's much harder for him to make counter attacks on amerlafrance. Amerlafrance now can much more easily rely on the fact that he probably will have much more orders than Georgie. So now the next turn comes and Georgie tries to expand. But again, he's always going just for three army attacks. So what does it mean? Perhaps that the three army attack will be the only George's option to take a territory. So let's say there's 80% chance of success, 20% chance of failure. And if George just keeps trying to make these attacks over and over again, he will eventually fail one of his attacks and it will delay his card gain. So let's say if he for example, reinforcement is only 4 pieces. So let's say George makes something like 4 attacks of 3 armies each, and he relies on them all to succeed, and that's of course less than 50% chance to be successful. So it means that if George did deploy one extra army every single time, he would get the reinforcement card with ease, and that would only cost George 4 extra armies. And he would have also at the same time, he would be much more guaranteed to make successful expansion. Because if George fails his attack, it's not only that he fails to get card piece, he also fails to get a territory, like to expand successfully. And it means just extra cost. It's not only that George loses 5 income, like it gets delayed. And he also loses his ability to take West Russia more efficiently. And now he is in a bad position. So he could, he lost one bonus already. So he's in very bad spot, so the best thing he could try to do, I guess at this point he should have maybe even surrendered, because amerlafrance is still at his 3 bonuses, and Georgie is now down to 2 bonuses, and basically this should be viewed. Georgie had 3 bonuses, amerlafrance had 3 bonuses. All of them were easy to be taken, and now because amerlafrance has taken 1 bonus from Georgie, amerlafrance now has 4 easy bonuses. Georgie has 2 easy bonuses. And what is about the other bonuses is that they all are having 4 army neutrals, so all the remaining bonuses are not as efficient. So Georgie has much less likelihood to be able to catch with amerlafrance by just expanding into other easy wasteland free bonuses, because West Russia has got 4 army neutral, same applies to other bonuses. While in the meantime, amerlafrance did get 4 easy bonuses, like South America is still available for amerlafrance, And for amerlafrance to take South America is much, 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 much cheaper than West Russia, also much, much cheaper than West United States, but I've already mentioned that. So on this type of game, even on a regular strategic 1v1, you should prioritize your starting bonuses, and you should prioritize maybe to make an offensive on the opponent. Because all the other expansions now are much a little bit more expensive because of extra neutrals added. So your starting bonuses come first, and expansion to the other bonuses comes second. So now Georgie is trying to force through amerlafrance, but now amerlafrance has income so big that you can just safely stall in one position, and in the meantime you can just make all the expansions he wants and just win the game long term. I guess amerlafrance just trying to play it safe, and in the meantime he's just trying to expand, get more income, maybe find the actual positions of Georgia and so on. Now amerlafrance could have made some predictions. So okay, he sees that 12 armies are deployed to Taiwan. Now, Georgia already has 5 base income, and he has East China, so it leaves the 3 mystery income for Georgia. So it means that where possibly could Georgia be? South Africa, which is a bad bonus, so probably unlikely. And the other option is Scandinavian Peninsula, which again is far away from amerlafrance, so amerlafrance probably is not in a good position to strike it. But still amerlafrance could try to expand to South America, West Africa, and try to at least prevent Europe for Georgia. Or he could rely on the fact that for Georgia all his expansion is very bad. He just doesn't have an option to expand efficiently. The best he could do is try to go for West China, but that could be countered with Japan, Hawaii, Korea, that combination. So basically Georgia does not have any good expansion options, and is doomed short term because his income is already down, and is doomed long term because it doesn't have a proper expansion. So I guess now amerlafrance decided to stop his expansion midway. Now West United States is something like 5 territories for 5 income. So now amerlafrance has stopped 2 of his expansions midway, which is not a good decision, because if you do start a plan, it's best to fully complete it. Because you already, like amerlafrance has easy time taking South America, now he has easy time taking West United States, so it's generally bad to stop your plan midway. Even if your plan was not that good to begin with, but you still have gone halfway with your plan, so it's much better to complete a bad plan rather than skip starting new plan every single turn. So now Georgie realizes that he probably is not going to defend his positions. But again, he is relying on 3 army attacks so much, and because of that he just keeps failing again and again and again. And each failure like that prevents him from getting bonus, for example. So that failed attack is immediately -4 income for Georgie. An additional -1 income because Arkhangelsk will get another chance to defend itself. So again, Georgia is just taking too much risks, and as a result he gets the expected result. And overall, in the end, he gets more losses than gains. So now Georgia is basically trying just to delay the game, I believe. Because there's no way he's going to recover from that, he should have realized it. Because, okay, Georgie has 2 bonuses, but what does amerlafrance has? He has 2 of his starting bonuses, he has Indonesia, he has got Australia. He could just make them out, and it would have been very easy for Georgie to realize that he's not going to win the game. But Georgie keeps going, and he, I guess he decided that maybe he'll be able to out expand amerlafrance. The amerlafrance has already got a huge lead, and it's just basically very, very unlikely. So Georgie to even have a chance to get more armies than amerlafrance. Georgie doesn't simply need to meet the two armies. He needs to get more armies than amerlafrance so that his difference and amerlafrance. Like difference between amerlafrance's and Georgie's armies would start to shrink. Georgie doesn't simply need to get a bonus. He needs to get more incoming amerlafrance, and it's simply not going to happen based on the layout of the map. So basically, at this point, Georgie is just wasting his time and amerlafrance's time. So amerlafrance is just expanding. Probably he already knows where to expect Georgie to be at. And Georgie attempts to make a heavy attack. But again, what is he going to try to achieve with that? Let's say he manages to break both Pakistan, both West China. That's only minus 9 income. It still leaves amerlafrance with 25 income. So, even if Georgie was successful, it would still be in the lead. Like, amerlafrance would still be in the lead. So, I should realize that Georgie, even if he does some damage, it's still not enough. But even if he does something smart, it's still not enough damage to amerlafrance because Georgie is not going to get 17 net income gain. It's basically not happening with current condition of the map. And amerlafrance is just going to have massive, massive income lead over Georgie. So Georgie tries to delay amerlafrance from advancing forward. Basically, it did perform well in one front, but because amerlafrance has twice the income, amerlafrance put effort to two fronts. So it's just natural that Georgie can only delay amerlafrance in one front, but it doesn't matter because amerlafrance will be advancing in another front at the same time. So again, now probably Georgia realizes that it's not going to win because income difference is just too huge. So finally, Georgia surrenders. So what could be learned from this example that both players should try to expand as efficiently as possible. Like amerlafrance should have prioritized going for South America because going for it is much, much cheaper. Perhaps what should be taken into notice is not simply income per territory ratio, but rather income per neutral counter ratio because but South America had four territories to be taken, and the West United States had like eight territories to be taken in worth of neutrals alone. So amerlafrance could have had a more efficient expansion, and Georgia was just simply trying to take all the bonuses at the same time, which was a bad idea. He decided to go for a bonus too big for him to handle on the first turn. And after that, he just ended his plan midway. He just started to split all over the place. And George's plan relied on always succeeding in his three armies attacks. And it's basically a bad idea. Because eventually, those three army attacks on a weighted random setting will fail. So if your expansion requires you to successfully take bonus in one turn, you should make the extra investment and you should try to take the bonus in a safe manner. And there were even some turns where Georgia was not in immediate disadvantage, like he still could have really afforded to make those one extra deploys to make his expansion much more reliable. So on weighted random, it's probably should be done is just make a calculation, is it worth to fail an attack? Because is it worth to spend one income to make sure your attack is 100% success, or risk make a risk and fail the attack and then get extra losses because now you need to take the territory again. Like if you because you fail to attack to take territory once, now you need to attack it twice, and multiple attacks mean multiple losses for you. Another possible thing is now you fail to get closer to your opponent, you probably failed to take a bonus, so additional losses on top of that. So it's best to avoid the risk as much as possible, or try to make sure that even if there is a risk, you still have good chances to succeed. Like something like at least 75% plus, 80% plus, something which is much closer to 100% success ratio than 50% success ratio. So thank you for watching, and the next review will be based upon a more different template. So perhaps for you it will be a kind of template which you might not have seen for some time, and perhaps it might be more exotic settings for you to see, and perhaps some you might learn more things from the next game. So anyways, thank you for watching. I hope that this video was informative for you, and I hope that the knowledge you gained here will help you to play a little bit better in your Warzone games. So thank you for watching, and have a very nice day.